in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, it is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Confess your sins before our Lord, please recite with me the second confiteor.
I confess to Almighty God, in the presence of the Blessed Virgin Mary, all the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned through my own fault, in my thoughts, in my words, in what I have done or failed to do. I ask the Blessed Virgin Mary, all the saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
As an act of penance today, I ask that, of course, as we honor the sacrament of the Word of God throughout the year and throughout our lives, I want to make sure that we take some time to dip our nose into the Word of God. Take 10 minutes this week. Set your cell phone on the outside of the door. Close the door. Come in a room all by yourself with nothing else. And spend 10 minutes in Scripture. Set the timer for 10 minutes. 10 minutes with our Lord as he speaks to you through his word. Again, 10 minutes of scripture. Seems easy, but it's one of those things we just have to go out and do. 10 minutes of scripture this week. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. May our Lord Jesus Christ absolve you, and with his authority vested in me, I absolve you from all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Pursue love, but strive eagerly for the spiritual gift, above all that you may prophesy. On the other hand, one who prophesies does speak to human beings for their building up, encouragement, and solace. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest.
The precepts of the Lord give joy to the heart. ordinances of the Lord are true, all of them just.
The precepts of the Lord are enduring to our hearts.
Though your servant is careful of them, very diligent in keeping them, yet who can detect failings? Cleanse me from my unknown faults.
The precepts of the Lord are enduring to our hearts.
From what in sin especially restrain your servant? Let it rule not over me, that I shall be blameless and innocent of serious sin.
The precepts of the Lord give joy to my heart.
The second reading is from the letter of St. James. Come now, you rich, weep and wail over your impending miseries. Your wealth has rotted away. Your clothes have become moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded. And that corrosion will be a testimony against you. It will devour your flesh like a fire. You have stored up treasure for the last days. Behold, the wages you withheld from the workers who have harvested your fields are crying aloud. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on earth in luxury and pleasure. You have fattened your hearts for the day of slaughter. You have condemned. You have murdered the righteous one. He offers you no resistance. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be.
Do not prevent him. There is no one who performs a mighty deed in my name who can at the same time speak ill of me. For whoever is not against us is for us. Anyone who gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ, amen, I say to you, will surely not lose his reward. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a great millstone were put around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed than with two hands to go into Gehenna, into the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life crippled than with two feet to be thrown into Gehenna. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. Better for you not to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into Gehenna, where their worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you.
Precepts of the Lord give joy to the heart. Words taken from our responsorial psalm, Psalm 19. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
All right, another word for precepts is law, and another word for law is rules. And rules, anybody really like rules? As a kid, of course, I dreamed of rebelling against rules, didn't we all? As a teenager, I became creative, as we all did, in how to break them. And now as a dad, I have to create and enforce ones that are fair. Most of them make sense, I would like to think. Our recent one is no standing on top of the kitchen stools. And while I think it's quite fair, it's often met with the response, I'm not, while said party is actually standing on the kitchen stool. The thing about our rules is, at some point, they all wind up making sense to us. They were all put and enforced there for a reason. But it often takes a little time and a little wisdom to get there. I know at some point, standing on kitchen stools will get there. And though I don't dare proclaim that I know the exact meaning and intention of every single one of God's rules, his laws, his precepts, I feel like I'm in the know enough to realize that they are oftentimes on a different plane of existence than all of us. One of my favorite meldings of what we consider God, the divine, and what we consider man is actually with distribution of Holy Communion. Some of you have come from different parishes within our denomination or different practices altogether. So we've seen a bunch of different ways communion, for lack of a better word, happens. Throughout my priesthood, I've heard all sorts of sides of the argument of when communion happens. And also, when does the bread and the wine become the body and blood of Jesus Christ? And how exactly? Some would argue that if we have the, and normally we don't have it today, but if there was one of those symphoriums here with a little cup that's like this tall and has a top on it, some would argue that if you never took off that top right there, then that body, that bread, would never become the body of Christ, as if the divine prayer spoken at the altar couldn't penetrate metal. I can tell you that that was written in books of Catholic law before. There was a standing rule for some time that if you forgot to do something, if you ran out of communion, you could take this right here, this unblessed bread, as we can see here, and you can just say, this is my body. And it would be considered the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And some would believe that just those simple words with enough intention would do that. Now, people who do believe that still, I have trouble arguing with them, but of course, you want to know the answer to, all right, what's the actual answer now, theologically? Our prayer is, of course, beginning when we start Holy Mass, in the name of the Father and of the Son. And the prayer concludes when we begin our Eucharistic prayer, when I announce which one, and when we get to that point, this is my body and this is my blood, it takes that entirety of that to turn that bread and wine into the body and blood of Christ. So it's not just those simple words. Now I mention this, and in all sorts of rules, not because I want you watching me like a hawk going, oh, he tripped over his words right there. Maybe it's not as much body and as much blood as it should be. I mention this all because it's really, really can be a challenge to interpret whatever is God's will versus whatever us humans pack on top of it or on the sides of it or try to get inside of it. St. James is the author of our second reading today and speaks to the terrible fate that comes with not the rich, but the unjust rich. The unjust rich. And that the whole irony of it all is that it is their wealth that will one day condemn them. There's a balance to be had if one is rich. But man, how hard is that? We know what Christ says, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to get into heaven. But I got an interesting story. Did any of you ever hear of Chuck Feeney? Chuck Feeney? Yeah, I didn't think so. Maybe somebody just doesn't want to raise their hand. If you've traveled before, in an airport, have you ever seen a duty-free shop? Okay, no, a duty-free shop. Well, this guy invented that. And not only did he invent it, he somehow owned it, however you can own it. And he became a billionaire 9 times over because of his invention of duty-free shops. He started the duty-free empire. And this is a guy who wanted to make sure and he spoke about his entire life. He's 89 years old now, but he wants to die penniless. So he built his wealth, he built his $9 billion empire, he accomplished all of that, and when he got old enough, he said, now I'm ready. And then he started giving away vast amounts of money, billions of dollars at a time, to various things, charities, to education, more than half of it went to education. Extreme. $9 billion to nothing. And though not a religious man, he grew up Catholic, he went to Catholic school, and he has stated that he always knew the values of what he learned in that Catholic school of not taking it with him and not being able to. Point of all this, and mentioning a guy who's not necessarily religious, is that God's will really does work through all types of people. Because we know in our lives, we've all lived nice, full lives, or getting to that point of living nice, full lives, that we have known some very good people, some good moral people, that didn't have a lick of God in their entire life, or a touch of church in their whole life. So how do we kind of filter through that as religious people? First reading from Numbers kind of gets us there. And it shows quite vividly the idea of prophecy and the descent of the Spirit and what it would do. Upon 70 elders chosen by God to help Moses, because Moses wasn't enough. Moses was not God. He was a wonderful prophet, but he needed help doing God's work. And although doing 68 out of 70, even shooting free throws or something, is a wonderful percentage, wonderful, it wasn't good enough for some for being present in that camp when God sent that Spirit down. Eldad and Medad were not there at first. And Moses used this as a chance to teach young Joshua and others what a gift it is that there are people outside of the realm of God who are willing to do good moral work, or even willing to do God's work. If we fast forward from the time of Moses some 1600 years to the time of Christ, and we heard the gospel, we can't help but notice the similarities of the stories here. Last week, I mentioned how the disciples were arguing amongst them, and how silly it was about who was the greatest of them all. And I mentioned a funny story with my brothers. At least when my parents visited last week, they did not think it was funny, but I still did, about who loves the one most. But today we see that their growth is still needed. They were still immature in some ways. They wanted no competitors in their status as disciples of Jesus, as those who were under his wing. Now, early in this chapter, we don't hear it, but this is where this whole message is coming from in the gospel today. There was a boy who was possessed by a demon, and try as they might, none of the disciples were able to cast that demon out of that boy until Jesus came and was able to and said, y'all got to have faith. That's what you need. You didn't have enough of it. And now to open our gospel passage today, we hear of somebody, not even worthy of a name, who is casting out the demons in the name of Jesus. Not a follower, not an apostle, just some guy. Now what? They're complaining about this one who is doing an inherently good thing in the name of an inherently a good person. They're complaining about it. In sports, we would say, a man being team players right now. They're not playing for the team here. But Jesus goes further. He needs to teach them something. They need to get something out of this two inherently good things happening. And this is where we got to sort out the will of God versus the will of man and everything here. He starts going into the chopping off of stuff. And the reference to mutilation, we sort of get what he's saying. It's better to avoid sin in this regard. It goes to extreme. The reference to any sort of mutilation is an illustration of decisive action to avoid sin. And of course, doesn't advocate literally chopping off body parts, although we have history of that happening. Just think of the movie where the person who's trying to put a drug or an alcohol, they literally take everything and pour it in the sink in such a cinematic and decisive way. That's a little more accurate to what Jesus is trying to say there. Decisive and be active against your sinful ways. But it also speaks to relationships, Jesus' words. That it takes wisdom. And that sometimes in relationships, they get to the point where severing a relationship that you have with a person or people, a place of work, or whatever, is for the greater good, for your greater chance at salvation of all parties involved. Jesus is speaking through all of this in just those few words of cutting off body parts. The gospel does recreate that portion of the story of the Old Testament that we heard, but look how much clearer and concise it is, that whoever is not against us is for us. Maybe Chuck Feeney and his once unlimited wealth isn't religious, but being charitable to worthy causes and giving them from more to giving to less, he's showing how that can be possible. If you're not against us, you're for us. Christ guides us today with some sharp and stark imagery of avoiding sin in order to do God's will. And isn't that the balance of everything today? God's will versus man's will. We strive to enter in God's kingdom in one piece, because that's the goal over everything. Jesus states that, even though two pieces or more is okay, although teachings and reprimands can be sharp, it comes back to that very first little piece of scripture. The precepts of the Lord give joy to the heart. Written by David, the king. May we find joy in doing his will and praying over and deciphering his will versus our own, even if there's all sorts of Eldads and Medads all around us. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I believe in one God,
seriously. Jesus teaches us the demands made of those who called to be his followers. May we reflect the holiness of our call and encourage the spread of the living word of God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For this sake, those who need health, comfort, and strength from God through our prayers, especially Richard and Edna Samuelson, Shannon Alvarino, Eugene Begin, Diane Black, Jennifer Kless, Jack Spilka, Jim Giles, Tom Slunka, Kim Penny, Nina Burquette, Linda Duffy, Mike Mattis, Nancy Cohen, Dennis Bielicki, Father Senior Joseph Sulpishak, Johanna Markevich, Dolly Olson, Al Kinecki, Bill Kastag, Joseph Biscoff, Nancy Raharik, Natalie Sulpishak, David Micah, Kevin Carlin. For all in our prayer list, for all friends and family members, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those members of our parish, our families, and our circles of friends who have died in the hope of eternal life, especially the departed members of our local Spojnia branches, for Cindy Amberty, for their souls, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty God, we, the people called to follow your Son, confidently bring our supplications before you, asking for simple and courageous faith, through Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Do not quench the spirit, do not despise prophetic utterances, test everything, retain what is good, refrain from every kind of evil.
Thank you.
better sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Sanctify our offering, Lord, our God, and so transform it by your Spirit that it may become an eternal gift worthy of you. We pass this to our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Thank you.
your death, Lord Jesus, we proclaim. Your resurrection, we celebrate. Your returning glory, we await. Therefore, Father, we remember his saving passion, his glorious resurrection, and his exaltation at your right hand. We await his coming in the fullness of majesty. We here set forth this sign of our faith in him, who offered you the perfect sacrifice and gained for us eternal salvation. Send your Holy Spirit, the giver of life and holiness, upon us and upon these gifts, the bread and wine of eternal life. Holy Spirit, come to us, fill us with your gift of grace. Take these gifts from our hands, Lord God, as an acceptable sacrifice, to which we offer ourselves to you, so that the bread which we break and the cup which we bless may be a sharing in the body and blood of your Son. May all who receive from your heavenly altar always remain united with you, together with all your saints and chosen ones. Blessed and glorious Virgin Mary, the Mother of our Lord, with your prophets and apostles, with your martyrs and confessors, with all who stand about your throne in praise and prayer. And also, Lord, to share in that glory to the departed and to those who remember before you. Deal with them and with all people according to your merciful kindness, and let perpetual light shine upon them. Remember also your servants on earth, whom we invoke your mercy, especially, Lord, as we celebrate this Mass for Spojnia Sunday 2021, for the secretaries and hierarchy, for all those within the realm of Spojnia. Bless your church throughout the world, grant it unity and peace, renew the earth according to your promise. All peoples, and grant that all nations may give you thanks for worshiping and praising your holy name. We ask this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Through him, with him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
May the partaking of your body and blood, Lord Jesus, not be cause for my judgment or condemnation. Though I am unworthy to receive this great sacrament, through your loving kindness, may it become my safeguard and healing remedy. My saving Master, awaken in me a living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy mind. Through this communion, make me your willing servant, zealous to fulfill your holy will. May it at last cement me entirely with you, my Lord and my God. I will take the bread of heaven and call upon the name of the Lord.
Lord,
body of Christ, bring me to everlasting life. May the blood of Christ bring me to everlasting life. This is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called to the table of the Lord. For those who worship with us virtually and those who are receiving sacraments spiritually this day, we offer. Most loving Jesus, I adore you in the most blessed sacrament in which you are truly present. I love you above all things and I long for you in my soul. Since I cannot receive you sacramentally, I ask you to come spiritually into my heart and heal my soul. I embrace you and unite myself with you. May I never be separated from you. Inflame my heart with the fire of your love, my Lord and Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
salvation and everlasting life. You have given us this bread, Heavenly Lord, having at the sweetness of your fruitfulness.
Forever and ever.